continue on part two of suffering. What about the problem of pain and suffering? Last week we talked about the intellectual problem. So many people, they have this question, not because they actually are suffering, not because they actually are going through anything, but they're asking specifically because they want you to be stumbled in your faith. They ask because they want you to deny God because suffering exists. How can a good God exist and have suffering exist at the same time? That was last week. If you guys need that question answered a little bit further, you know, feel free to look at that sermon of last week. But this week we're going to look at the next stage of this. But first of all, let's review. For those of us who just need to review, self-review is always good. We learn through repetition. First of all, for a slide first, what is evil? Anybody remember what evil was? The absence of good. Holy cow! You guys are listening. Praise God. It's the absence of good. I used an example of a donut hole, and then Doug shot it down. But it's a good example regardless. You guys remember Doug actually hit a box of donut holes. I know where the donut holes are. Shut up, Doug. Yeah, we love Doug. But we talked about the donut holes. We talked about a donut hole, but it's not actually a thing. We can actually refer to the hole. Same thing we talked about with darkness. Darkness is not a thing. Darkness is the absence of light. If I stand here, I can see I have a shadow. But the shadow, I can point to it, and I can say, you talk about shadows, shadow of the dark, whatever. Bottom line is, always the shadow is not a thing. The shadow is the absence of light. My body is blocking the light, making a shadow. It's not a real thing. And the same thing goes for evil. Starvation, which is evil, is the absence of food, which is good. Blindness, which is evil, is the absence of sight, which is good. Illness, which is evil, is the absence of health, which is good. So what is good? We talked about that too. What is good? Good depends on the purpose and design of a thing. The purpose and design of a thing. There's a huge difference between a good burrito and a good computer. There's a huge difference between a good book and a good movie. Books are always better, right? We're not debating it, it's just a fact. Books are always better. There's a difference between a good husband or a good man and a good piece of dark chocolate. Where look at me like, well, which one's better? That's debatable. But there is a difference between a good piece of chocolate and a good man. The point is that what makes something good is whether or not it fulfills its purpose. So what's a good movie? We would say, well, is it entertaining? Did you enjoy the characters? Does it have a consistent plot? Did it make you laugh? Those are the kinds of things we ask. Or what's a good cheeseburger? Cheese, bacon, it's a little juicy, salt, there's a little bit of some pepper, some Lowry's. I am so hungry. But the point is, that's what makes a good cheeseburger. But that's what makes a thing good, is if it fulfills its purpose, which leads us to God. We can ask the question, well, what makes a good man or a good person? Abraham Lincoln says, when I do good, I feel good. When I do bad, I feel bad. That's my religion. But a good person loves others. A good person is kind to animals. A good person takes their responsibility seriously. A good person is known by their good works. And a good person, defined by God, searches after God and applies his word in their life. How do we know this? It's because of the Bible. The Bible is God's owner's manual for humanity. And it tells us what we're created for. That's how we know what good is. And it doesn't end there. God created everything. God created dogs, cats, oceans, mountains, men, women. Each is good in their own way. And each is good based on their purpose as they were designed by God. And God created everything in Genesis. And God said it was... Try it again. I was tearing up a little bit. Now you guys are making me sad. God said, and it was good. It was good. Everything was good. Everything that God made was good. God is good. He can't make anything that's bad. Now when we put this information together, we're summing up last week, God created good things. When God created the universe, it was good. In the fullest sense of good. There was no disease or famine or sickness or poverty. It was literally good. But then evil entered the world. It wasn't God who allowed her, who made it enter the world. Man chose to sin. We chose to leave behind a perfect and good world for our own selfish desires. We wanted something that was imperfect, because we are too. Which leads us to conclude that any evil that exists is not a product of God, because God did not create evil. Nor does he produce evil. Evil is a product of a fallen world, which has chosen to rid itself of God's authority. And here's the question. By whose authority did we reject God? By our own. We as a human race have chosen to reject God's authority. And we have broken the marriage covenant that God made with creation in the garden. This is why God's people are compared to an adulterous wife throughout the scriptures. We have here Jeremiah says, "Surely as a treacherous wife leaves her husband, so you have been treacherous to me, O Israel," declares the Lord. Now when you guys are Christians, when you see, "O house of Israel," don't go, "Yeah, they're stupid." You have to go, "God's people made a mistake." Israel, it calls Christians the new Israel in the New Testament. Don't think you're better because you're post-Old Testament. O house of Israel, if you and I were all alive then, we would be following the same program. We cannot think we're better because we have more information. Think about this. How the faithful city has become a whore. She who was full of justice, righteousness lodged in her. It says, right, we used to do righteous things. But now murderers lodge there, is the point. And the most vivid is Ezekiel 16:30-33. It says, "How sick is your heart, declares the Lord God, because you did all of these things, the deeds of a brazen prostitute, building your vaulted chamber at the head of every street and making your lofty place in every square." He's saying, you're setting up places to prostitute yourself everywhere you go. In the most public of places, you are prostituting yourself. He says, "Yet you are not like a prostitute, because you scorned payment. Adulterous wife, you who receives strangers instead of her husband. Men give gifts to a prostitute, but you gave your gifts to all your lovers, bribing them to come to you from every side with your whorings." The point is, he's saying, wait a second, before you start looking at the prostitute and saying, "Prostitutes, they're sick and evil," he goes, wait a second, no, church. You are worse than a prostitute. Prostitutes get paid. At least they're getting something out of the arrangement. You, as a church, you pour yourselves out to idols and false teachings, and you follow things that are not God. That is like giving yourself away for free. He says, don't look down on the prostitute. At least she gets paid. And this in and of itself should be enough for us to realize that though we as individuals may believe that our suffering is unjust, we as a people, as a human race, are getting exactly what we deserve. And just like a husband of an adulterous wife, God does not have to answer any request or any prayer. But here's the thing. Our God does. Our God does. This is what grace is. Grace is giving someone a blessing that they do not deserve. As we can see, we as a species do not deserve any blessings of any kind. Yet God still blesses us. That's grace. Like we discussed last week, that only answers the intellectual question of why bad things happen. Through a study of what it means to be good, we realize that as Scripture teaches us, all have fallen short of the glory of God. We realize that as Scripture teaches, all have fallen short. No one deserves anything that is good. Which leads us to love the Lord, because God gives us so many good things. And if you understand grace, you will praise Him for the tiny bit of blessing, because you understand you don't deserve even that much. But that was last week. We talked about the intellectual problem. The thing is that that is a conversation I would never, ever have with somebody who's in the midst of suffering. It's true. But that is not the time to tell somebody, you know what, you don't deserve anything. I know you lost your son, you lost your husband, you lost your grandma, you lost your mom, you lost your dad, but you know what? You didn't deserve them anyway. You don't say that. That is not how you deal with suffering. There's a different thing we do with that. That's just how we answer the intellectual question. So I'm going to walk you guys through this book. It's called, here, let me show you. It's by Dr. Feinberg. It's Where Is God? This is a great man who when I went to seminary, he was my advisor when I went to TED's for my philosophy and religion program. And it was because of Dr. Feinberg that Shauna and I were able to survive school. Because when I was going to grad school, I was in Chicago while my wife and family were in Wisconsin. I was only home about 9 days a month and working those 9 days. So I would go to school full time. I was taking 16 to 18 credits, full-time seminary, and then I would come home and work, and then Sean tried to still be a husband and a dad to my babies. But it was because of Dr. Feinberg that I was able to get through this. But Dr. Feinberg wrote this book, Where Is God? And he understands suffering. He understands suffering more than most of us do. Dr. Feinberg had a normal life wherein he married the woman he loved. They had 3 children, he became a professor, and life was pretty darn good. Professors, can I get an amen? Professorships are pretty nice. He was just living the dream that he always had. But all of a sudden, his wife's health started deteriorating. And at first, they just thought she was sick and whatever, but pretty soon they found out she had Huntington's disease. If you know anything about that disease, it's awful. She slowly but surely lost her ability to walk. She soon lost the ability to move her arms. She couldn't even turn her head. Pretty soon, she was completely paralyzed because of this awful, awful disease. And what they come to find out was that it ran in her family, but they had no idea. Her mom was hospitalized her whole life, but they told her that her mom was hospitalized because she had a mental illness. Never told her that she had Huntington's disease. They never told her that, by the way, you have a chance of passing this on to your children. They had 3 kids. And when they had these 3 children, she found out she had this disease. They didn't know what to do at that point because every one of their children has a 50% chance of getting this awful, awful disease. And here's the thing, if they tested them, the insurance companies would never cover it. So they can't even have their kids tested. They can test it and find out very quickly. But they don't want to get their kids tested because the insurance companies will jack up the prices. So here's the situation. Loss of health. They were sick over the potential life that they unwittingly forced on their children. Angry towards his wife's family for not telling them the truth and hiding it from them. There are so many unanswered questions, thoughts, and regrets. Here's a man who's like, they're at the prime of their life, and they just realize we're not going to be able to spend that life together. What will their kids do? Should their kids even get married, knowing that they will be a burden on their spouse? When should they get tested? Should they get tested? Should they hide the truth from their kids themselves? And then the biggest question of all, why did God allow this to happen? But here's the thing, in reality, it doesn't matter what the reasons you give to them, what explanations you come up with. The reality is that none of your arguments are going to alleviate even one shred of the pain and suffering they're going through, especially when they first found out. Because the pain is too real, they can't even hear your words. So how should we respond to suffering in the lives of those around us? That's what we're going to study today. First of all, number one, don't talk, just listen. The biggest mistake, and you guys take notes on this, and I'll tell you, from doing funerals, being at the bedside of so many people, I'll tell you right now, if you think you've never done these things, think again. Some of the most loving people say the most awful, insensitive things to the people that they are trying to alleviate the pain of. So please, take note. Biggest mistake we make, first of all, is opening our mouths. So much pain is added by just words. Great example is Job. Job is listed as one of the most righteous men in all of history in the Bible. But through a series of horrible events, he lost his children, lost his health, lost his worldly possessions. And in the early days, his friends came to him and visited with him. And the text says in Job 2:13, it says, they sat on the ground with him for 7 days and nights, but no one spoke a word because his suffering was so very intense. That's the exact quote. For an entire week, they didn't say anything because they knew there is nothing you can say to that person. They just lost, he lost, I think, 7 children. Everything he owned, servants, possessions, his health. When they came there, he was scraping himself because he was covered in blisters. He was sitting in ash and scraping himself. His wife even says, curse God and just give it up. That's how much suffering he was going through. And his friends did the right thing. But the moment they screwed up the whole deal was when they opened their mouths. We must remember that nothing we can say can fix anything that our loved ones are going through. So oftentimes the best thing to do is to simply cry with them. Hold the person who's suffering. Simply be there with the person who's suffering. In the end, it is only in listening that we can even earn the right to be heard in the first place. As we learn, it is through your patient listening that you show the person who's suffering that you actually care. Then point number two is, if you are going to talk, choose your words wisely. Dr. Feinberg explains a few statements you should never make. First of all, if there's anything I can do for you, let me know. This one is the most shocking because we all have done this. I'd ask for a show of hands, but every single one of us has said this to somebody. You're in the line at the funeral. Somebody has passed away. You're like, if there's anything I can do for you, let me know. We all have done this. But consider this. Someone you care about is suffering and grieving. They are distraught and hurting. You come to their home, you comfort them, and before you leave, you say, anything I can do, please don't hesitate to ask. And this sounds like a kind gesture. But from the perspective of the sufferer, you have just given them a job to do. What sounds like an offer is actually an assignment. According to grief counselors, what you have really done is you've added to the plate of the grieving party. This is coming from decades of counseling experience, not me, this doctor. It's like saying, I know you're suffering, but could you take some time to find me something to do? That's what you're really saying.
Yeah.
What counselors recommend is rather than ask, just do something. If this person is someone you care about, you should be able to know what their needs are. Make an assessment on your own. Determine what they need. Grab a gallon of milk on your way over. Buy some groceries. Make them meals. Make a pot of coffee. Clean their house. Mow their lawn. Shovel their walkway. Do something. But don't give them more to do. You want to alleviate their suffering, not add to it. I said, don't feel bad if you've done this. We just aren't in the suffering to know. And praise God, we can learn from other people's mistakes. Next, I understand where you're going from. How often do we come up to somebody who's in the middle of suffering and go, you know what, I understand where you're going from. Unless you have literally gone through exactly the same thing, you have no idea what they're going through. People follow this statement because they think that they're empathizing, they're sympathizing. But it's not the same thing. Feinberg warns us also, he says, even further than that, let's say that you have suffered the exact same event in your life. He says, just because you've suffered that exact same event doesn't mean you have any idea what I'm going through. He said, this is a quote, he says, you can't understand because you are not me. You don't have my particular personality, my particular emotions, my background, my experiences, my family, or my relations. And he says, and he adds again, he says, and to know that you feel as bad as I do does not make me feel better. It makes me feel worse. So you come to somebody at a funeral, and you're like, you know what? I know exactly what you're feeling. I lost somebody also. The person who's suffering is like, so basically what you're telling me is that the funeral of my loved one is reminding you of your loss, so now you feel worse. You don't want to do that. He suggests, and counselors suggest, it's better to say something like, I can't imagine what you're going through, but I'm here for you. I can't imagine what you're going through. You don't have to try to let the person, you don't have to try to make the person believe in any way, shape, or form that you understand. It doesn't help. Just say, I can't even imagine, but I love you, I'm here. The next phrase is, this is awful. This probably spared you from something worse. And this, people say this all the time. You guys would be, I can't even, I have so many quotes from people in my life who I am the pastor of, who have come to me and said, somebody told me the most insensitive thing. This is one of those. When you lose a loved one, people try to comfort us, and sometimes they convince themselves that if they tell you that this horrible event, they'll tell you this horrible event has spared you from something worse. I'm going to give you an example, and this is just awful. I'm going to read it right from here. So this is one of his grad students. His wife and he, young couple, first kid, were fine. Late in their pregnancy, lost the baby. This is what somebody said to him, which is awful. You know, it's probably a good thing that your son died. He probably would have grown up to be a problem. Maybe he'd have been a drug addict. Or would have refused to follow Christ. God knows these things in advance. He was probably saving you from that trouble. Could you imagine? You have just blamed the unborn child. They're grieving the death of their son. And then you say, yeah, your kid was probably such a sinner that God killed your baby. He let Hitler live. He let Stalin live. He let Pol Pot and all these other awful individuals all live. But your kid is so sinful, hypothetically, so sinful in the future that God was like, you know what, I'm going to spare you a life of your kid being a drug addict. Well, thank you, Jesus, for that. And here's the thing. Scripture never, ever, ever, ever says that God killed a kid for some hypothetical sin that he may or may not have committed in the future. And secondly, what the person is saying is that they should be grateful for the evil in their life. That's what you're saying when you say that. Listen to that. You are saying that the sufferer should be grateful for the evil in their life. This is awful. This is evil. This should come as a blessing. No! You don't call evil blessings. Evil is evil. It is never, ever, ever good. This leads us to the second point here. Again, a lot of Christians do this. Romans 8:28. Oh, don't worry, man. All things work out for good for those who believe. Christians, this is not the verse to drop on somebody when they're suffering. Quoting scripture is a good strategy. But this passage is not helpful. This passage has a context. If you read the whole verse, it says, we know that all things work together for the good of those who love God, those who are called according to his purposes. Think about this. According to Dr. Feinberg, such verses as Romans 8:28 cause more doubt than comfort. Because what you are doing is you are trying to take an emotional pain and you're trying to fix it with an intellectual argument. Again, you're trying to say, don't worry about it. Think about this. You shouldn't be suffering so bad because consider this. It does not help the person who's struggling or suffering. You're basically saying, cheer up. God is going to make it good. You don't know how or when, but it'll be awesome. That's insensitive. Dr. Feinberg, he writes that to see how, he says here, I'm going to read it. It is hard to see how that good, whenever it comes or wherever it will make up for the evil that has just happened. He continues, how insensitive to imply that a tragedy of a lost loved one or some other tragedy really isn't that bad or isn't even evil at all. Because God will eventually bring something good out of the experience. Don't worry that you've lost this person you love. It'll be good. No, it won't. Not right now. John 11, we read about the death of Lazarus. You guys know this story? Jesus is out doing what Jesus does. It is Jesus. He's out about preaching the gospel. Praise God. He gets a letter and says, they say, hey, Lazarus has died. And Jesus knows full well he is going to raise Lazarus from the dead. He knows without a doubt in a couple of days it'll be fine. But does Jesus say that? When all of his disciples are bawling and crying and tearing their clothes and throwing ashes on their head, does he say, guys, come on, buck up. It'll be fine. I'm going to raise him from the dead. Suck it up, man. It's going to be great. God's going to be glorified. Was all that true?
Yes.
Did he say any of that? No. There's one verse that it says, and all it says is Jesus wept. That is all it says, Jesus wept. It's like one of those Bible verses when you go to church camp, and they're like, hey, you got to memorize a whole bunch of Bible verses. Jesus wept is the Bible verse that every single kid will memorize, and it's so easy. But there's a deeper meaning to it. Jesus wept. And it's not because Jesus was sad for Lazarus dying. He knew he was going to raise him from the dead. He wept because all of these people were struggling and suffering and hurting. And Jesus just wept with them. He doesn't tell them, don't worry about it. This is the next one. He says, we're all going to die someday. Again, this assumes that the pain of losing someone you love can be healed by the reality of mortality. The problem is that knowing death will someday come doesn't make death right now any easier. Well, we're all going to die. Who cares? What? That's what you're saying. It's awful. Why would you bring up, and the thing is, this is a side note, why would you bring up death or pain in the midst of somebody's death or pain? It's awful. Again, it doesn't help. And this is the one that everybody drops. I've heard it at every funeral I've ever been at. Well, I guess it's just God's will. Telling someone that their suffering is God's will simply gives the sufferer an enemy to name. Who's seen the movie Taken? Anybody seen the movie Taken? It's okay, you can get it. Anybody have to be one. It was rated PG-13. Taken. Liam Neeson's daughter is kidnapped. And he makes it his life's mission to find her. You have to see the movie to understand. Daughter's kidnapped, the dad knows it. What's he do? First thing he does is he wants to identify who's responsible. But why does he identify who's responsible? Anybody know? He's going to kill them. And why does he want to do that? Why do audiences watch that video and go, yes? It's because that's justice. God is justice. We are made in God's image. We want justice to happen all the time. When something is wrong, we want it fixed. That's justice. Our righteous indignation flares up. We demand justice. That's the way it should be. But when you say it's God's will, what you're actually saying is, you know all that pent-up anger and pain you're feeling? Yeah, that's God's fault. Just so you know, you're suffering right now. God doesn't care at all. He wanted it to happen. He knew the suffering you were going to suffer right now, and he still thought it would be better to cause that pain. We talked about this last week, but this is the thing. Be careful. This is a Christian view. There are millions of Christians who believe that God literally does cause evil to happen. There are a lot of Christians who actually believe that. But here's the next point. A time of suffering is not a time to give someone a lesson in theology. Be very careful. Just because you don't agree with their theology, it is not the time to correct their theology. My view of theology, for example, if you guys have been here for, I've been here for almost 2 years now. And if you haven't been listening, let me just paraphrase. God does not orchestrate every single act or event. That's my opinion. I don't believe that God creates evil. For me, the death of a loved one is no more God's fault than if my tree fell on my neighbor's fence. I was like, oh, that's awful. I'll help you clean it up. But I wouldn't go, oh, that was my fault. When I read Scripture, I don't see God who I don't see a God who controls everything. I don't believe everything happens for some deeper reason. Because logically, that means that even evil itself must have some kind of deeper good reason. And I don't believe that's so. God can make good come from evil, like God can, like the idea of making lemonades out of lemon. But the thing is that doesn't mean that God made evil happen. I don't struggle with evil, personally, especially from other people, because I don't believe that God ordains it or that he makes it happen. That's just my theology. But it doesn't mean that I accept evil with a smile. For example, I've been wronged. I've had my car broken into. I've been robbed. I've been held at knife point. I've been in some horrible situations before I became a believer and after I became a Christian. I have my best friend overdosed on heroin. Another example is that Sean and I were in a car accident. You guys don't know this. Sean and I were in a car accident years ago. We had two little babies. We were finally going to go on a date. We hadn't gone on a date in like 6-7 months. Drop off two girls, Nina and Tamara. Drop them off at Grandma Ryan's house, mother-in-law's house. And Sean is 9 months pregnant. Big pregnant. Like bursting at the same time. We're driving down the road. We're only a half mile from my mother-in-law's house. And we're driving through a green light. A guy pulls out. Smash. Shauna's seatbelt comes undone and she goes into the windshield. I am losing myself. I pull Shauna out of the window. Her head is laying on her shoulder. If you can imagine somebody's neck bending that far back. She's in the window. I pull her back. Her hands are like this. Bones are sticking out. I assume my wife is dead. I was crying and screaming, and I don't cuss, but I made up for it in about 5 minutes. I got out of the car, I wanted to just beat the heck out of anybody that was involved. This guy, I started cussing at him, I apologize, but I'll leave that out. I said, hey, what the heck are you doing? I had a green light. He says, I had a green light. And I ran over to hit him. I'm not proud of it, but I ran over and punched him in the face, and he went like that, and I could tell that he was mentally disabled. And I said, just go to the other side of the road. I thought this whole time, I thought Sean was dead. And my 9-month-old son, I thought was dead. But here's the thing. Because of my theology, at no point during that time, at no point during Sean's pregnancy where she had to wear a neck brace, she had her hands casted, where I thought she was, literally thought she was dead, at no point did I go, God, why did you do this? I didn't point at God and go, God, why did you do that? Why would you make my car crash? It never occurred to me. It was pretty obvious. A guy ran a light. But that's me. There are other Bible-believing Christians who completely disagree with my view. And they are Christians, fully Christians, who just don't agree with that. They believe that God has orchestrated every event. They would argue that every action done by people is pre-planned from the beginning of time. They would say that this includes even acts of evil. But both these views have a downside. First of all, my view of God, I don't believe that he's the origin of evil. But the thing is that my view doesn't give me any hope of some kind of deeper meaning. That's one downside. If something bad happens, I don't go, wow, I wonder why God did this to make something better happen. I don't believe that. I just believe evil things happen because we live in an evil world. But the thing is that my theology never pushes the blame on God. There are people who do believe that. They believe that they have solace in the fact that every evil event is orchestrated by God for some deeper purpose and deeper meaning, and praise God. But the thing is that when evil happens to them, they have to struggle with, why would God do this to me? And Dr. Feinberg is one of those people. This is one of the debates that he and I had all the time. And I love Dr. Feinberg, but I said, we don't agree on this. But in his book, he says that his theology was the main problem that he had for his doubts. But here's the thing. Despite the fact I don't agree with his theology, despite the fact that my reaction would be different, despite the fact that, according to my view, God would not be responsible, it is not in the midst of suffering that I would ever, ever, ever correct his theology. It is not the time to pull out the Bible and say, let's talk about this. Let's look at some Bible verses. It's not the time to correct somebody's theology. You, as an individual, you come to a person, a Christian, you're struggling, and they have their theology. Let's say their theology is totally goofed up, but you know they're a believer. It's not the time to drop some nugget of wisdom on them. You may have the greatest argument in the world for why this event occurred. You may hold the answers to the world's greatest mysteries. But in the midst of suffering, it is not the time to help change this person's worldview. Even if their worldview is wrong. Unless, this is the last point, unless they lack hope. The thing is, Dr. Feinberg and I, we don't agree on some things, but we agree on a lot more than we disagree on. And no doubt, if you guys read his book, Where is God in the Midst of Suffering? He has hope. And his hope is in Christ. Christ is our hope and our salvation. Believers are not. That is our hope. This earth is not our hope. We know eventually we will leave this place. Heaven is not our hope. So many people are like, oh, the rapture. No, the rapture is not our hope. Heaven is not our hope. Even the non-Christian believes in heaven. That's where the good people go. Even the concept of God is not our hope. Many religions use the term God so loosely. Well, you know what? Let's pray to God. If you're in a room of Muslims and Jews and Christians and Mormons and Jehovah's Witnesses, everybody can get down with that. That is not our hope. Our hope is in a specific God, Jesus Christ, only. It is in Christ alone where we find our hope. It is in Christ Jesus which separates our faith from the thousands of others. There are many people who would say, God, yes. And we'd say, no, different God. We don't worship the same God under a different name. You worship a God that doesn't exist. We worship the only true God. It is Jesus' life, which we try to model to the world around us. And it's in Jesus' death that we find our hope. We're all sinners. We all live in a fallen world. We will all suffer eventually. This is the problem. You know, everybody talks about teenagers, right? Teenagers they do stupid things, they think they're immortal. It's because they don't realize they will suffer someday. As you get older, your body starts to ache a little bit more. You start to realize, close. I plucked my first gray eyebrow. I was shocked. I was like, what? Shocked and I was just like, oh my gosh. I plucked that bad boy. It was pointing like straight out. The gray ones are unruly. What's that talking about? The thing is, we will all suffer. Suffering is not a possibility. Suffering is an inevitability. What we put our hope in is our choice. And as Christians, you have the duty, you have the responsibility of providing that information because you are providing the opportunity for someone to know the truth so they can trust Jesus as well. You are plan A. There is no plan B. Someone's in the midst of suffering, that is when you give them the truth. I've done funerals for people who weren't saved. Very sad. I'll tell you right now, I didn't get up there and go, let's talk about how nice a guy he was. I got up there and I said, hey, you guys, you know what? He was a nice guy. I loved him. Good man. But let me tell you what he wants you to know right now. He wants you to know the Savior of the universe. His name is Jesus Christ. Let's not parse words here. I'm not talking about God. I'm not talking about Allah. I'm talking about Christ, Jesus, of the Bible. And I give them the gospel. Because I'll tell you right now, just like we have in with the death of Lazarus and when Jesus was talking. Guy dies, he goes down to Sheol, and he says, let me go back and tell my brothers and my cousins and my friends. Everybody who dies knows God better than we do. Non-Christian or Christian. And they want you to take your responsibility seriously and tell others about it. So they have at least a choice to follow Christ or not. I want you guys to open your Bibles. 1 Corinthians 15, 54-58. I purposely didn't put this up here because I want you guys to have that Bible in your hand. We have a pew Bible on page 962. You guys can tell you something. The Bible that we as Americans take for granted has the truth of eternity in it. It is the Word of God. You have access to the Word of God. And how many of us put that book on a shelf until Sunday? We pull it down, and if Pastor Joshua doesn't have the Bible verse, I'm going to go with it. You guys, you have life in your hands right now. Life. Life eternal. I want you guys to read this with me here. 1 Corinthians 15:54-58. 1 Corinthians 15:54-58. Page 962 of the Bible. Death has been swallowed up in victory. Death, where is your victory? Death, where is your sting? Now the sting of death is sin. The power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God who gives us the victory through, specifically, through who? Jesus Christ. There is no doubt who he's talking about. He does not want us to be confused. Therefore, my dear brothers, be steadfast and immovable, always excelling in the Lord's work, knowing that your labor in the Lord is not in vain. When the verse we quoted Romans 8, it says, for all things work for good for those who believe and all that. This is what he's talking about. For those who are in the will of God, who are serving him and doing good works in the name of God, your work is not in vain. That's what that verse is talking about. It's not talking about in your suffering, suck it up. All things work for good for those who believe, because you guys know what? God has your back. If you're a Christian, you have the Holy Spirit. God is guiding you, even in your mistakes, because we're going to make mistakes. Even in your mistakes, God can use that. He can use it to train you, he can use it to mature you, and he can use it to help others. The good work of these verses command us to do is a work of bringing the saving message of Jesus to those around us. It is only in this hope that we can finally look death in the face and know our path is secure and our suffering will not be in vain. Look at that one more time. Death, where is your victory? And people misuse these verses and they try to like say, oh, this is the rapture. No. It just says death. Death. Talking about dying. When you die, you will get rid of this corruptible body. You will be immortal at that point. Death, where is your sting? Death, where is your victory? The only reason we can point at death and say, I'm okay. Death, you have nothing on me, is because we know we're trusting Jesus Christ forever. Let's pray. Father, thank you so much, Lord, for being so good to us. Your word is so clear. We need you, Jesus, to find salvation. You are our everything. You are the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last, Lord. All things work through you, and we pray, God, that you help us to accept your truth. Help us to be your hands and feet. feet, especially those who are suffering, Lord. We pray that as you wept for those who loved Lazarus, help us to weep. As Job's friends obeyed you in their wisdom in the first 7 days, help us keep our mouths shut. And Lord, when and if and when we do speak, we pray, God, that you would give us wisdom to not lay more of a burden on those who are suffering, but to be a blessing like you would have us be a blessing, Lord, because you and your grace, you always bless and you never, ever hurt. And we love you, Lord, we praise you for the opportunity to be your hands and feet in the lives of those around us. Because someday, Father, we know that we will be the ones suffering. We pray, God, as we are serving those who are suffering now, that your people will serve us when we need that service. We love you, Lord. We praise you. We thank you for being able to look death in the face and say, where is your sting? The hope that you give us.